day, Walton Verona High School sits atop a small ridge overlooking the town of Walton, located at the southern edge of the Kentucky suburbs of Cincinnati, Ohio. Lost between the modern school and the adjacent tangle of interstate highways is a very different history. From 1935 to 1942, this ridge in Walton served as the northern Kentucky headquarters in the battle against a sinister enemy that threatened the very foundation of American life. Destruction of our nation's soil.
Boats sail on the river, ships sail on the sea, but down at Walton, Kentucky, you will find CCC.
On Wednesday, July 17, 1935, 23 enrollees of the Civilian Conservation Corps, commanded by Captain Robert Adams, set up 5 tents on the ballpark in Walton, a site then owned by John L. Vest. The grandstand became a temporary kitchen, and the first meal served there was corned beef. The small group of enrollees began digging a ditch for a water main, constructed power and telephone lines, and erected additional tents. Less than a month later, on Thursday, August 8th, an additional 169 men arrived at the camp. These 192 men comprised the initial complement for the CCC Company 3541. The following Monday, 17 carloads of lumber arrived by way of the L&N Railroad, and construction of permanent buildings began with the help of local labor. The first building completed was the mess hall.
However uncomfortable and inconvenient at times, we shall recall our days under canvas with pleasant memories. It was in these tents with blackberry vines as carpet, with sheets of dust as covers, with sand a part of our daily diet, and our old grandstand as our rallying place in times of storm, that we really come to know and understand each other. Under adversities, our true selves are revealed.
On November 30th, 1935, the 68-foot flagpole was completed, and the United States flag was flown for all to see. The raising and lowering of the nation's flag at dawn and dusk would become a well-known tradition of the camp. The camp was designated as Soil Conservation Camp No. 5, Kentucky, the fifth of what would be 27 CCC camps in Kentucky entirely dedicated to fighting erosion and conserving soil. To the men of Company 3541, though, it was known as Camp Bean Ridge.
I was standing by the wind.
In 1905, in Louisa County, Virginia, a young scientist with a background in chemistry and geology was researching why crop yields in the county were declining. Hugh Hammond Bennett had joined the Bureau of Soils 2 years earlier. What Bennett saw in central Virginia convinced him that soil erosion was not just a problem for individual farmers, but was an issue that was affecting entire rural economies. Later in his career, Bennett spent much of his time traveling the nation and writing about soil erosion. His concerns eventually gained national attention with the publication of a 1928 U.S. Department of Agriculture bulletin entitled Soil Erosion, a National Menace.
After 24 years spent in studying the soils of the United States, it is my opinion that soil erosion is the biggest problem confronting the farmers of the nation over a tremendous part of its agricultural lands.
By 1929, soil research stations were established throughout the country, but the aggressive response to soil erosion that Bennett hoped for would have to wait for a new administration and a new deal. Bennett found an ally in Franklin Roosevelt, who also realized the dangers of soil erosion. When Roosevelt began managing his family's estate in Hyde Park in 1910, he was disturbed to learn that the farm was only capable of producing half the crop it had been producing several decades before. He was also alarmed by the large and ever-growing gullies along the steep slopes, which had been cleared for maximum cultivation. With every rainfall, he watched his soil wash down the Hudson River.
I can lime it, cross-plow it, manure it, and treat it with every art known to science, but it is just plain run out.
Only 17 days after his inauguration in March 1933, Roosevelt proposed to Congress the creation of, quote, a civilian conservation corps to be used in forestry, the prevention of soil erosion, flood control, and similar projects, end quote. 10 days later, Congress passed the Emergency Conservation Work legislation. Initially, the Forest Service operated the Civilian Conservation Corps camps on public forest and park lands. So when Bennett was named as director of the new Soil Erosion Service in September 1933, he would look for help from the Civilian Conservation Corps to get the job done.
With frontiers closed to further agricultural exploitation, American farming must adopt the pattern of conservation to survive. A changing pattern of agriculture is in order. Farming styles must change from straight lines to curves on sloping land, or we will lose the scant remains of the thin layer of topsoil. There is no alternative, because farmlands already are deteriorating and the wastage cannot go on.
While some CCC camps had been set up to demonstrate soil conservation practices for farmers to study, it was Bennett's view that additional camps were needed to help farmers adapt their farms to modern conservation practices. The idea of using federal funds and the CCC on private land was resisted by both President Roosevelt and Interior Secretary Harold Ickes. Yet Bennett argued that most of the farmers in question did not have the funds necessary to build fences, forest slopes, or stop farming some of their land because of the risk of temporarily lower yields and incomes. Additionally, he felt that even with adequate funds, individual farmers were not the appropriate agents to solve such a monumental problem.
Private landowners could not carry through the necessary educational, demonstrational, and experimental work even if they had the funds. I am so deadly earnest about the absolute necessity of carrying on this work as a matter of vital national economy.
Eventually, it was decided that Bennett could establish CCC camps to work on private land. The first such camps were set to open in the summer of 1935. On March 21, 1935, while a congressional committee discussed legislation regarding the service, a large dust cloud originating in the Dust Bowl of the Midwest settled over Washington, D.C., providing extra urgency needed for Congress and the President to take action. Bennett's goal of a fully functioning Soil Conservation Corps was finally achieved by an act of Congress in April 1935, 30 years after his first inspiration as a young scientist surveying the farms in Central Virginia.
240-acre farms are lost every day in the year through soil erosion, and the nation has lost $20 billion because of this alarming wastage.
Poems are made by fools like me, but Roosevelt above made the CCC.
The Civilian Conservation Corps itself offered a unique blend of military and work camp life with educational and recreational opportunities. To individual families struggling to put food on the table during the Great Depression, the CCC represented a steady paycheck and employment with room, board, and medical care for one or more of their sons. Each enrollee made $30 a month, from which the phrase, another day, another dollar, originates. However, the enrollee was only allowed to keep $5, while the rest was sent home to his family. The young men lived in military-style barracks under the command of Reserve Army officers, and the importance of building character was stressed throughout the program.
Many people realize only too little the stressed importance of character, but our government has accounted its exceptional qualities by establishing the Civilian Conservation Corps, giving new life to young men who found themselves suddenly faced with idle hands and minds, which generally rides downward to destruction unless they are taken from the depth of idleness and lifted to the wheels of industry and activity. What might have befallen our country were the three C's never established can only be pictured in the minds of far-seeing people.
A more immediate benefit of CCC life related to diet and health. Enrollees also had access to medical and dental care, exercise and recreation equipment, facilities, and fields. The CCC camp offered these young men three good meals per day. Recruits typically gained 4 to 10 pounds in the first 2 months. One recruit is said to have grown an inch taller and gained 40 pounds in 6 months. Food like that served at the annual Thanksgiving dinner may have contributed, including as it did creamed mushroom soup, crackers, hearts of celery, radishes and green onions, olives, bread, coffee, roast turkey, sweet potatoes with marshmallows, Brussels sprouts, oyster dressing, tomato juice cocktail, cranberry sauce, fruit salad, ice cream, candy, and pumpkin pie.
Being in the CCC is like five aces in a strip poker game. You don't know what might be pulled off next.
By March 1938, more than 2 million young men had served in the CCC, most of them between the ages of 18 and 21. The CCC's educational program was a cooperative effort of each camp's educational advisor, members of the camp's army staff, and the technical staff. In 1938 alone, 1,500 educational advisors and more than 20,000 persons offered instruction to enrollees. On average, each camp had about 17 instructors. The education and training provided men with a new outlook on life. More than two-thirds of the enrollees had received no systematic training before reaching camp. 39% of them had not completed elementary school, and 3% were functionally illiterate. About 25% never had a job of any kind prior to joining the CCC. In the first 5 years, more than 50,000 of them were taught to read and write, more than 500,000 received remedial instruction in grade school subjects, more than 200,000 studied high school subjects, and many received high school diplomas. About 50,000 of the CCC enrollees pursued college courses while in the camps. Enrollees received on-the-job training related to project work, which was supplemented by evening classes in carpentry, auto mechanics, surveying, stonemasonry, mechanical drawing, agriculture, radio repair, photography, and more. Altogether, 1 million young men received job training instruction. Camp classes abandoned lecturing for discussion. Each class focused on a practical end project. For instance, an English class produced the camp newspaper, while a surveying class processed the data from a field party. The CCC administration was constantly aware of its responsibility to help enrollees find satisfactory employment. Enrollees were advised on how to conduct a job search, and by 1938, about 470,000 former enrollees were employed in private industry. The focus on education combined with the on-the-job training proved to be the most effective means of converting thousands of jobless and often homeless youths into better citizens and happier individuals.
Roosevelt's my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to sleep in barracks. He payeth me once a month. Yea, though I dread KP, I will fear no evil. His work and money, they comfort me. He prepareth a table before me in presence of all three seas. My plate runneth over.
Farms in northern Kentucky were identified as among those most in need of soil conservation assistance. After World War I, prices plummeted, and by the early 1930s, cultivation increased, but farms in northern Kentucky were producing less and less. Campbell County legislators lobbied in 1935 for a CCC camp to be placed near Alexandria to address issues of erosion. Ultimately, however, the town of Walton in Boone County was selected as the campsite for this region.
There's a canvas-covered camp down at Walton, bravely fighting its battles alone. There's a place that is haunted with memories. 'Tis the CC camp we call our own. If I could recall all the heartaches that OKKP has caused me to bear, if I could replace the dishes to their place and hear old Bert when he swears, but there will come a time when UCCs must all return to your homes. But I'd give all I own if I could but go home to that CC camp we call our own.
Most of the enrollees of Camp Bean Ridge were from nearby cities, towns, and farms. Often such men were disappointed to be assigned to soil conservation camps near their homes, rather than in more exotic locations like Glacier or Yosemite National Parks. This was no accident, however. While Camp Bean Ridge would be working to rehabilitate private lands, there was no illusion that the camp could adapt every farm to the new conservation methods. The work done on private lands was to serve as a demonstration for neighboring farms. The camp newsletter, usually an internal document for the men enrolled in the camp, was viewed at Walton as a method of continuing the education of the enrollees, as well as the local media and people in the surrounding farms about the methods and reasons for soil conservation. And by selecting, educating, and training men from regional family farms, the agency hoped that the men would adapt and maintain their own farms in the methods learned during their time in the CCC. While other CCC camps built visible and often monumental infrastructure about which enrollees could be proud, but might never have an enduring connection to, a soil conservation camp promoted conservation on a personal, local level.
The work presented by the Walton camp can be summed up in four words: greater dependence on vegetation.
In general, farming techniques thought necessary to increase yield were actually contributing to the soil erosion and formation of deep gullies. These techniques included deeper plowing, plowing in straight lines down the slopes of hills, and removing all brush and trees from even the steepest land to increase the farmed area. Such techniques led to rainwater washing massive amounts of soil into the creeks and rivers. To combat this loss, the Soil Conservation Service suggested plowing fields in curves along the contours of slopes. Such contour plowing would create terraces to better hold the water and slow its progress down the hill. In some areas, the CCC dug small ditches and earthen ridges to increase this effect. In an effort to repair badly eroded gullies, workers created temporary dams to catch soil. Once soil filled the gully, a layer of mulch was laid down and fast-growing black locust trees were planted to secure the soil. Steeply inclined areas were reforested to prevent and stop the future formation of gullies. In less than 3 years, Camp Bean Ridge planted nearly 500,000 trees as part of this effort. These same trees could then turn a profit for farmers when sold as fence posts for cattle pasture. The Soil Conservation Service also suggested crop rotations to best utilize the land, rejuvenate the soil, and provide a variety of crops for eating.
Pastures need a rest, just like human beings, especially during midsummer dry weather. If overgrazed at such times, pastures may become eroded. Use of meadow for supplementary pasture cuts down on expensive summer grain feeding and keeps up milk and beef productions as well.
Farming practices that control erosion also help farmers to get the maximum benefit from rainfall during periods when they need it most.
Put those gullies to work and they will produce wildlife in return. The same plants which control soil erosion frequently will provide food and nesting sites for desirable species of wildlife. Of course, it is better to protect the land so that the gullies won't form, but there's no use worrying over spilled milk, and when the gullies are already there, the best thing to do is find a job for them. Farmers interested in putting waste areas on the farm to work producing wildlife are advised to visit the camp. Though too early to plow the fields, many area farmers were already planning to use erosion control practices. 1938 brings in a new group of erosion-conscious farmers in this community, changing tillage style because hundreds of farmers visited the camp during 1937. On these visits, farmers saw entire farms with all row crops on the contour. They saw steep hillsides with strips of erosion-resistant crops alternated with strips of clean-tilled row crops. And they saw long slopes with a combination of erosion control practices in operation, including strip cropping and contour farming.
Take out the injured and dead trees first, then remove the inferior and less desirable species that crowd the crop trees and compete with them. In this way, seasonal firewood and timber products may be harvested and the most thrifty trees left to produce a more valuable crop.
Waste materials about the farm often can be used to good advantage in controlling soil erosion and at the same time improving wildlife conditions. Burning or discarding vegetable waste about the farm simply means the unnecessary loss of a valuable asset.
In addition to the demonstration farm at the camp in Walton and the work at farms throughout northern Kentucky, Camp Bean Ridge also helped the Boy Scouts on a reforestation and gully restoration project at Camp Hill outside Morning View in southern Kenton County. The CCC initially demonstrated techniques and gave lectures to the scouts, who agreed to continue the conservation work. Some men were also put to work collecting nuts. In the summer of 1935, enrollees collected 900 pounds of hickory nuts and 1,700 pounds of walnuts to be sent to CCC tree nurseries. The seedlings for these nuts would be used in future reforestation projects throughout the nation. The men of the CCC were also drafted to help with other community needs. One December, carpentry students at the camp made toys for an orphanage in Versailles, Kentucky. They often assisted in fighting brush fires, and during the devastating Ohio River flood of 1937, nearly the entire camp provided relief aid by rescuing stranded citizens, securing and delivering clean water, food, and clothes, and even opening the camp as an emergency shelter.
A grass fire covering more than 100 acres on four adjoining farms, which threatened two farmhouses, was extinguished by farmers and CCC boys after battling the blaze for 9 hours.
I cannot praise too highly the individual and cooperative efforts of the CCC men who were engaged in flood relief work during the disastrous Ohio River floods in the spring of 1937.
The camp also opened its gates to visitors for special events. Dances, tours, and anniversary celebrations provided excellent opportunities for promoting an understanding of the camp's conservation techniques. Often for these events, music was provided by a popular African-American WPA orchestra from Cincinnati.
Things here in camp are running too good. We've been eating like kings, and this is the first time in all our CC months that camp life seems just like home life.
The camp has changed from a pitiful mud hole to a place of beauty. Yesterday it was only a muddy sea. Today it is a bud. Tomorrow it will be our social heritage in bloom once more.
Camp events were not the only avenue for the young men at the CCC camp to interact with residents. Enrollees would often walk to the James Theater in Walton to see the latest film, or would make their way to concerts at DeVue Park, where many young women also congregated. Marriages between CCC men and local women often highlighted the local news.
Miss Shirley Jack, age 21, married Sergeant William Burtman, age 24. The groom is a member of the CCC in Walton, his residence being Greenville, Ohio, and is a splendid young man, and the bride is the daughter of Mr. and Mrs. J.M. Jack of Beaver Lick. Their many friends wish them a long life of happiness and prosperity. Lige Baker of Hamilton, Ohio, and Walton CCC Camp marries Ethel May Roberts on May 17, 1936. Mr. Baker is a member of the Walton CCC Camp and has made many friends during his stay here, and we extend to him and his winsome bride congratulations and best wishes for a long life of happiness.
The Camp Crier, the camp newsletter published by Camp Bean Ridge, reported on other gossip as well.
It looks like Bayless is losing his power over the women in town. I notice that his girl has been going out with another one of the Clark Gables of a certain building of this company.
The newsletters featured humor, sports scores, announcements of camp tournaments, and poetry written by the enrollees.
Man, money sure talks around here.
Yeah, but all it ever says to me is hello and goodbye.
Have you passed the word of kindness or a friendly smile today? Have you cheered a total stranger as he went upon his way? Have you smiled or whispered kindly? Did you fret or did you grin? Did today bring forth tomorrow like a loser bound to win? Did you speak kindly words to others that met you upon the way? Do you think you passed the test to live another day? And when tonight you lay in slumber, no tears of telling sorrow, as the Lord speaks from his golden throne, have you today earned tomorrow?
Other aspects of camp life included basketball and softball teams, which engaged in competition with local high school and church teams, as well as guest lectures on topics ranging from Abraham Lincoln to the motion picture industry. A large library of books and magazines supplemented the robust educational program at the camp. Occasionally, a measles outbreak would slow work at the camp, but more common were dental complaints. On one visit, the dentist found 91 enrollees with immediate dental needs. That day alone, he pulled 65 teeth and filled 61 more. But there were more serious dangers caused by carelessness with heavy tools or local hunters straying too close to the camp. But by far the greatest danger the men faced was driving to and from the camp to local events and area farms.
An urgent request that hunters refrain from hunting within rifle range of the CCC camp. There were no deaths of CCC enrollees caused by hunters last year, and we feel that the small number of accidents caused by hunting in previous years is due to the splendid cooperation given by the hunters themselves.
On Friday, April 10th, Harry Link, age 19, of Kiefer, Kentucky, was seriously injured in a car accident while returning from a dance outside Williamstown. Link was an enrollee of the Walton CCC camp. He was driving in his car at a high rate of speed and lost control of the machine when it crashed into an oil station. Link suffered a skull fracture and was taken to St. Elizabeth Hospital in Covington for treatment. On Saturday, July 15th, 1939, three enrollees were injured in a one-car crash in Fowler Creek Road near Independence. Telford Mershon of Piner and Urban Gunning and John Bender of Independence, all 19, were treated at St. Elizabeth Hospital in Covington. Telford Mershon suffered a fractured pelvis and ribs. Police were unable to determine the cause of the accident.
The CCC is full of boys with plenty of work to do. The CC boys are full of joy and full of sorrow too. These boys are fed, these boys are clothed, they're given a place to sleep. They're given a monthly paycheck, and a bit of this they keep. Some boys are glad, some boys are sad, and some are both together. But what is this that caused it all? It's nothing but the weather. For when it rains, they do not work, at least not in the field, and when they have to work a day, when all would like a leave. Some come from far, some come from near, but when they get together, they usually have a jolly time, and join right in together. They build a fence, or plant some trees, or even haul some rock. They're good at almost anything, and this is not a shock. So you can very readily see exactly why it is that when a farmer wants some trees, he calls for help from the CCCs.
The fact that 120 farmers in Boone, Grant, Kinn, and Gallatin counties are cooperating with the camp shows that they realize that soil erosion is an acute problem in this vicinity.
In April 1938, Camp Bean Ridge hosted its largest celebration yet, the 6th anniversary of the CCC. The program included music provided by the newly created Simon Kenton High School Band, an old-fashioned burgoo at the camp, talks by various officers and dignitaries, and tours of nearby farms that had adapted to the new farming techniques. One such farm was the J.W. Huey Farm in Union, Kentucky. The CCC surveyed, planned, and adapted 158 acres on the Huey Farm, while Huey made a 5-year agreement to continue conservation practices.
Government agrees to construct wire fence, gather 149 tons of limestone, lay out all erosion control practices, such as crop stripping, buffer strip, and contour furrows in pastures. Mr. Huey agrees to furnish all materials for fences, have limestone crushed and applied to fields, furnish superphosphate to be used where needed, establish and follow a 4-year rotation consisting of 1 year corn and tobacco, 1 year of wheat, and 2 years of sod, furnish a pasture mixture of clover, bluegrass, and timothy hay, practice erosion control for at least 5 years consisting of strip cropping, buffer strips, contour plowing, seeding, and cultivating, sodded waterways to be protected from plowing and cultivation, mature waterways will have sod strips of 23 feet left unplowed.
In 1940, the Camp Crier newsletter received a 5-star rating from Happy Days, the national CCC newspaper, and it was reported that a total of 161 farms in northern Kentucky had adapted to the new soil conservation methods. Other farmers would later adopt the methods demonstrated on their neighbors' farms. The work of the Camp Bean Ridge enrollees would continue for 2 more years until the Civilian Conservation Corps was disbanded in 1942.
With frontiers closed to further agricultural exploitation, American farming must adopt a pattern of conservation to survive.
This morning, as I chanced to gaze, I very seldom do, I saw a streak of flaming red in the sky of azure blue. It made me pause and contemplate very profound thoughts, to think that none could equal the things that God has wrought. 'Twas a picture that no brush could paint, no pencil could e'er draw, no poem could do justice to the lovely scene I saw. As I pondered on the subject, a thought was given birth. What a tiny person I am now upon this massive earth! It fired ambition in my soul. It made me want to be a hero in the game of life instead of just plain me. And I looked again. The scarlet stream had faded from my view. It was vividly enveloped in the sky of blue. All my thoughts now vanished. They faded with the scene. But I was not least surprised for who I was to dream. I am just a speck in the sight of God. To him I'm just a toy. And to the people of this aged earth, I'm just a lonesome CCC boy.
Thank you.